Welcome to the Warriors of Grace podcast, hosted by Dave Jenkins. Warriors of Grace is about helping men from generation to generation become gospel men in private, in the home, in the church, and in public through the Word of God. Now for today's episode, let's join our host, Dave Jenkins.
Welcome back to the Warriors of Grace podcast. My name is Dave, and I'm the host for this podcast. And today, we're going to get into episode 4, which is titled Hospitality, Opportunities for Relationships, Evangelism, and Discipleship. On our first show, we talked about what it means to be blameless. In our second show, we consider what it means to be the husband of one wife and fight for sexual purity. And last week, we consider the topic of sober-minded, self-control, and respectable. Now, today we're going to talk about what it means to be hospitable as an opportunity for relationships, for evangelism, and for discipleship. Paul tells Timothy in 1 Timothy 3:2 that an overseer must be hospitable. And he echoes this in his letter to Titus in Titus 1:8. The Greek word for hospital is philoxian. It indicates a love for strangers. In a day before holiday, and Christians were expected to extend hospitality to other traveling Christians or itinerant preachers. They were to feed them and they were to provide them for them a place to sleep apart from the dirty, the dangerous, and the unsavory inns. The word here is naturally expanded to include other forms of hospitality, but at heart it indicates a willingness to invite others into your home for a short or an extended stay. But why is there such an emphasis on this trait? Hospitality is a tangible outward display of godly character. An open home displays Christian love, but it also enables it. Hospitality creates opportunity for relationship, for discipleship, and for evangelism. It creates a context for modeling marriage, for parenting, and a whole host of Christian virtues. While we are to teach others what the Bible says, we are also to demonstrate what it says, and we do that by inviting people into our homes and into our lives. This applies to all Christians, not just to elders. See, while the Old Testament law places great emphasis on caring and protecting the sojourner, this care for strangers is made even more explicit in the New Testament. Peter writes to all Christians when he says, "Show hospitality to one another without grumbling," in 1 Peter 4:9. And Paul tells the whole congregation in Rome that they must seek to show hospitality in Romans 12:13. The author of Hebrews says in Hebrews 13:2, "Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." Paul instructed Timothy to extend the church's benevolence to a widow if she has shown hospitality in 1 Timothy 5, 9-10. Jesus taught that we be judged by our hospitality, but when we love and welcome others, we in fact love and welcome Him in Matthew 25:35-40. Hardly anything is more characteristic of Christian love than hospitality. Hospitality can be defined as the quality of or disposition of receiving and treating guests and strangers in a warm, in a friendly, and a generous way. In the New Testament, the Greek word translated hospitality literally means, as we've said, the love of strangers. Hospitality is a virtue that is both commanded and commended throughout the whole of Scripture. In the Old Testament, it was specifically commanded in Leviticus 19:33-34. "When an alien lives with you in your land, do not mistreat him. The alien living with you must be treated as one of your native born. Love him as yourself, for you are aliens in Egypt." Now, during his public ministry, Jesus and the disciples depended entirely on the hospitality of others as they ministered to them from town to town. Likewise, the early Christians also depended on and received hospitality from others. In fact, travelers in ancient times depended heavily on the hospitality of strangers, as traveling was dangerous and there were very few inns, and poor Christians could not afford to stay at them anyway. This generous provision to strangers also included opening one's home for church services. Hospitality was indeed a highly regarded virtue in ancient times, especially for Christian leaders. The writer of Hebrews reminds us to not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it, Hebrews 13:2 says. Indeed, in the book of Genesis, we read of Abraham's humble and generous display of hospitality to three strangers. Wealthy and aged, Abraham could have called on one of his many servants to attend to the three unannounced visitors. And yet the hospitality and the righteous Abraham generously gave them the very best that he had. And as it turned out, he had entertained the Lord and two angels. Genesis 18:1-8 says. See, Christians are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Ephesians 2:10 says. As followers of Christ, we emulate his love and his compassion when we show hospitality, not only to fellow Christians, but even more so to strangers and the less fortunate. In fact, we honor God when we are kind to the needy. Jesus said this in Luke 14:13. When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Christ also taught us the second great commandment, to love your neighbor as yourself in Matthew 22:39. And the parable of the Good Samaritan teaches us that the neighbor has nothing to do with geography, with citizenship, or with race. Wherever and whenever people need us, they and we can be neighbors like Christ and show mercy to them. This is the essence of hospitality. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus discusses the hospitable behavior of those who will inherit the kingdom. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me, Matthew 25:34-36 says. And these days, we often don't think much about entertaining strangers, but hospitality is still an important part of Christian ministry. By serving others, we serve Christ and we promote the spread of God's truth. You know, I said in these episodes that I was going to be honest and forthcoming about things that I struggle with. And as we talk about that, I want to be real with you guys that hospitality is something that I struggle with. In fact, even just recently, in the last year, the Lord has kindly brought my sister-in-law and her baby into our home, and she has been living with my wife and I, and that has been an amazing blessing, but it has come with a challenge because here we are. We are family, and we love and we care for each other. But there's been challenges. It's been very much a learning opportunity. And I can be honest with you that in many ways I've handled it well, and in some others I haven't, and I've had to learn. I've had to repent. I've had to ask for forgiveness where I've sinned, and so on and so forth. But overall, it's been a wonderful blessing to open up our home, to have the space. We have an extra bedroom, and so we have the space. And the ability to, and they have their own, you know, bathroom and space. And so we've been wonderfully blessed to be able to be in a place to open up our home and our lives to them. And it's been, as I said, a wonderful blessing, but there's also a challenge because I want time with my wife. She wants time with me. So we've had to learn to be more intentional while also giving them our time, and especially our young nephew, who's two. He has lots of time and lots of love and hugs, and he likes to watch Toy Story, and he's precious, and we love him. But there's been challenges, and one thing that we've found that helps us is to sit around the table and just have conversation about our day, just getting to know one another better, talking about things. We have a chore chart, so somebody cooks every day of the week, somebody does dishes, somebody takes out the trash. On the weekends, we have things that we do, whether vacuuming or dishes, clean up, sweep and mop the floors, clean up the little guy's toys, those types of things to make the house look nice. And I've never been really, in our marriage, my wife and we have never been really all that tidy, but I have commented over and over again, hey, you know, this is something that I think is important. My office space has never really been all that tidy. There's books strewn about and those types of things. And every time I post a picture of my office, I gasp in horror that that's what it really looks like. And but I try to pick up my office once a week and keep it pretty tidy. Make sure I vacuum it, dust it, make it a nice space. Well, you know, there's a lot that can be said about being hospitable. You know, it begins though with understanding hospitality begins first and foremost with understanding that the person and work of Jesus. You know, in the incarnation, Jesus became a man. He came on a rescue mission. He came to atone for the sins of his people. He came to die. In fact, Luke 19:10 says that he came to seek and save the lost. See, this is the thing about being hospitable, you know. We open our homes to people, but most importantly, when we open our home to somebody, what we're really doing is opening our hearts to Christ. Because Christ is the one who provides for our home. But most importantly, through his death, he has provided eternal life for us. So hospitality is a vehicle, a conduit. We can be instruments of the grace of God by not just opening our homes, which God gives to us as an act of kindness and provision, but even more so, when we open our homes, we're making ourselves available to the grace of God. We're saying, God, we're not going to just close ourselves off in these walls, in this home that you've given to us. We want to use this home as a vessel, an instrument to be used by you. Now, that requires dealing with messy situations and other people that you might not like, and that might make you uncomfortable and be difficult. But you know what? The Christian life is not a life of ease. As I said, opening up my home has been a challenge. You know, we have opened up our home before, and that's been a challenge. But what's been different this time is I've recognized not just the fact that my sister-in-law wants to grow and learn and really wants to help, you know, to keep growing in her own life, but also to realize, you know what? God has been gracious to my wife and I. He has given us this home, which is beautiful and wonderful and very nice, but supremely, he's given us Jesus Christ. And that's the most important thing to recognize in hospitality, is to recognize that everything that we have in this life is an undeserved mercy. It's a gift. It's a blessing from God. And when the Bible speaks about blessing from God, it's an undeserved gift to unworthy recipients. God the Father gives every good and good gift to his children, and he longs to do that. But we need to understand that God the Father doesn't have to give us gifts. He doesn't have to bestow on us anything. The only thing that a sinful, rebellious humanity deserves is everlasting, eternal, conscious punishment forever in hell. And yet, Paul would say, but what has God done? He's made us alive together with Christ. Colossians 1 tells us that he's transferred us from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of the Lord Jesus. You know, that's what's so amazing. As children of God, we have every reason to be, as Paul says to the Corinthians, to be generous givers. And part of being a generous giver isn't just amount of money that you give. It's understanding the heart behind why you give and the heart behind why you serve. That's what's so important about hospitality. That's why this is listed, because it really shows the heart. Are we serving the Lord for our own benefit, or are we serving the Lord for the benefit of others? You know, as Christians, we have been served by the Lord Jesus so well. You know, he has come to die. He has died. Even now, he has been buried and rose again. He's ascended to the right hand of the Father. He intercedes for us. He's our mediator. He's our sin-returning King. And on we could go with that. In every way, God has shown himself to be hospitable. He has reached out. He has generously provided the message of the gospel through his Son, who bled and died and rose again. And he sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us, to empower us, so that we could be hospitable to other people, and so that we could serve other people. So as we think about this category of hospitality, it starts with Jesus. Then it goes to the mission of Jesus. And then it goes to the present ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives, which enables us to be ambassadors of Christ to people. You know, you may not be in a position where you can be hospitable, but you can invite people over to your home. You can make yourself available to other people. You can make room in your heart, in your life, for other people. Because that's what hospitality is about. It's not just, okay, well, opening your home. It's about opening your heart. It's about being available. It's being available to be used by God. Yes, opening your home, whether that's a short or an extended stay, you know, that's something to prayerfully consider with wisdom. But what is beyond dispute is we as Christians are to be hospitable. So I want to ask you, do you see hospitality today in the way that we've described it? Do you see it as something that is central to the life of the Christian? You know, I know that hospitality is not talked about much in the church, sadly. But we need to talk more about it. It's something that is important because, as I said, an open home, it displays Christian love and it enables it. And what's more beautiful than that? What's more beautiful than that? To open your home and to make yourself available to be an instrument, a vessel to be used by God in the life of your family, in the life of your church, in the life of your community. You know, that's the other thing I didn't even touch on. Something that Rosaria Butterfield talks about in several of her books is this idea of having, you know, table fellowship, having people over, opening the Bible, having conversations about the Word and making a meal and, you know, just talking about Scripture and praying out loud. You know, that's powerful. That's something that all of us, you know, can do. Well, just as we wrap up this episode, you know, it's been a challenging one, I know, and these are all challenging, and they're eminently practical. That's the thing. As we wrap up this episode, next week, I just want to let you know, we're going to look and talk about what it means to be sober-minded and gentle and peacemaking. I want to thank you for listening to this episode of the Warriors of Grace podcast. Thank you so much for tuning in. I trust that you're finding these episodes helpful. I'm enjoying doing them and look forward to talking with you next week.
Thank you for listening to the Warriors of Grace podcast. If you enjoyed the show today, please subscribe, leave a rating on the app, and share our episode with your friends and family. If you want to, you can follow us on Instagram at Servants of Grace, on Twitter at Servants of Grace, or search Servants of Grace on Facebook. You can also find our show on the front page of the website servantsofgrace.org.